I want to speak about contentment. And I want to use as a text verse Hebrews 13 verse 5. This is one of those verses where people know part of the verse and people quote part of the verse, and you'll see what I mean. This verse, the second part of it is very well known. Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. The King James says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. We know that part of scripture, but that's not a full verse. And I want to read the full verse to you. And it says here, keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have, because God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. Now, Gavin ministered recently on the love of money. He spoke about the evil eye. And if you didn't get that ministry, you missed a good ministry, and you can get the tape, listen to it. We praise the Lord for the impact that ministry is having on the website and being downloaded in so many different countries. And I just want to read a certain portion of scripture in 1 Timothy 6 that touches on this whole thing of the love of money, and also once again makes reference to contentment. There is a doctrine that emerged in the 80s called the prosperity doctrine. At some time it was a lot worse than what it is in present days. It's kind of been toned down a bit. But I think that things like the current world recession have sort of helped. I was looking at something on the website the other day, one of these church websites, and I don't know even who it was, but they said, you can give your money to some television minister and help him to get a new Rolls Royce, or you can give your money and you can help the poor. And I think there is a lot of truth in that. And we've seen this where people have used the gospel to enrich themselves. And we've seen the prosperity message so taken out of proportion and distorted. And I want to say, I do believe God prospers us. God blesses us. And that blessing is not only to be measured in material means. 1 Timothy 6, and I want to read from verse 3. If anyone teaches false doctrines and does not agree with sound instruction of our Lord Jesus and to godly teaching, he is conceited and understands nothing. He has an unhealthy interest in controversies and quarrels about words that result in envy, strife, malicious talk, evil suspicions, and constant friction between men of corrupt minds who have been robbed of the truth and who think that godliness is a means to financial gain. But you know, we don't have to try and pull something out of scripture. It's right there for us to see. Very easy to see that godliness is not a means to financial gain. But godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. People who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap, and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge men into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Some people eager for money have wandered from the faith and have pierced themselves with many griefs. But you, O man of God, flee from all of this and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, gentleness. Fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of eternal life, to which you were called when you made your good confession in the presence of many witnesses. And then in verse 17 it says, command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant or to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to put their hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. You know, God wants us to enjoy ourselves. There's nothing wrong with enjoying ourselves. Sometimes the most miserable people are the people who have a lot and they don't want any friends in case their friends hit them for a loan. Command those who are rich to do good, to be rich in good deeds and to be generous and willing to share. In this way they will lay up treasure for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that they may take hold of life that is truly life. Covetousness is something that I've spoken about. I listened to a ministry of James Merritt a number of years ago that had quite an impact upon me on this very subject, covetousness, where he said that this is one of the Ten Commandments, and yet he said that he was reading, or he had somehow come across the testimony of this Catholic priest who had heard thousands upon thousands of confessions, and he said he had never ever heard a confession about somebody who had confessed to covetousness. The sin that nobody acknowledges, nobody is aware of. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's this and thy neighbor's that and thy neighbor's wife and thy neighbor's goods, etc., etc., to teach us to be content with what we have. And in Colossians 3:5, it says that covetousness is idolatry. And in some of the quotes, I got some very good quotes from different Christians through the centuries that I'm going to read out this morning. You'll see how this comes across. How that covetousness puts you on the throne instead of God on the throne. Covetousness is serving self and your own desires and your own will. But you know, during this week on Wednesday, I received an email from Liberty Life. And I'm going to read this email to you. And this is not a Christian email. This is not something that's addressed to Christians. And maybe it's not even written by Christians. But it was something that really caught my attention. And it's entitled, How Much is Enough? And why it's good to speak about it at this time is that all too often, all Christmas is to some people is getting gifts. Getting something. And we teach our children to just want more, and often there's a lack of appreciation. When I was watching the Gaither DVD not so long ago, where they came to Baragwanath Hospital and they handed out gifts at Baragwanath to the little children there, the terminal patients, the cancer patients and that. And you see the appreciation of small little gifts, and sometimes we see our children just sort of like discard things. And, you know, I know my son at one stage, he just had a whole cupboard full of things that many of them he had never even played with. There is a famous story about author Joseph Heller attending a party given by a billionaire. Another illustrious author, Kurt Vonnegut, informed Heller that the host, a hedge fund manager, had made more money in a single day than Heller had earned from his wildly popular novel, Catch-22. Heller responded, "Yes, but I have something he will never have. Enough." And you know, folks, later on I'm going to remind you of that. Have you got enough? Because there are many people who want you to make the next million, want you to make more and more and more, but they never have enough. Proverbs says, "He who loves money never has money enough." What Heller was talking about is knowing what really brings you happiness. Not how much we accumulate. There will always be someone who has more. We need to be thankful for what we already have. A job, a home, friends, family, food on the table. The idea of enough is worth thinking about as we go into the festive season. This is a time where we often feel pressure to spend and accumulate more things. We feel bad if we can't give our loved ones the gifts they want, and often feel obliged to buy gifts for other people so we appear generous. Perhaps we should focus more on the generosity of spirit, on giving of our time rather than from our credit cards. In the book How Much is Enough, Aaron Abbey and Andrew Ford talk about the importance of both finances and personal planning. At some stage in your financial planning, you need to ask yourself, how much money is enough? How much time with your family is enough? How much time to pursue your passions is enough? And how you can balance all this to achieve a true sense of fulfillment. This is as important as asking how much you need to be saving, because saving is the flip side of spending. Does all the stuff you're spending your money on actually bring you happiness? We tend to buy things to fill our home that do not bring us any real joy beyond the few minutes we spend actually buying them. We may find saving for a dream far more emotionally satisfying. I recently came across an article in Time that really brought the stuff we accumulate into perspective. In the article, organizational consultant Peter Walsh says, it's not necessary about new pots and pans, but the idea of cozy family meals that they will provide. People are finding that their homes are full of stuff, but their lives are littered with unfulfilled promises. Take a moment when you are with your family and friends to discuss what exactly it is that brings you happiness, whether you have enough, and what enough means to you. You may be surprised by their answers as well as yours. Our wish for you this festive season is that you find the time to fulfill your promises and that you start the year with enough. I found that an amazing article from a source like Liberty Life. And I trust that each and every one of us, as we go into this year as a church, as we fast and as we pray, we will start this year with enough. I pray that even after the message today, you'll be able to say to the Lord, Lord, I've got enough. The definition of contentment is this: the state of being contented or satisfaction. You see, satisfaction has to do with desires being met. And sadly, many Christians are not satisfied because they've got desires that the Bible actually says they should put to death. The Bible says put to death the lusts of the flesh. There are certain things we need to flee from, certain things that we need to deal with. And you know, if you don't deal with that, you're going to have unfulfilled desires. You're going to be unsatisfied. And yet Jesus said, I've come that you might have life and that you might have it to the full. Benjamin Franklin said this: contentment makes poor men rich. Discontent makes rich men poor. And you're going to hear a number of quotes today, but this is my quote, okay? I think it's something that I heard in the past that probably, you know, sounded similar to this. But basically, there are things that you need that you can do nothing about. You cannot change. But there are needs of others that you can meet. And you know, sometimes the greatest satisfaction that we can get is by meeting the needs of others. And that's why Jesus said it's more blessed to give than to receive. And so I really do believe that if you really want fulfillment, look around for needs that you can meet. And stop being focused on yourself and wanting to accumulate more. We can't call ourselves poor. Some of you may have got that email that I sent around recently. It wasn't a Christian email, but it basically was an actor in one of these television programs overseas who just said, I'm 63 and I'm tired. Tired of hearing about people who live off the government and don't work and we've got to support them, etc., etc. And tired of Americans calling themselves poor when they've got two cars in the garage and they live in a fancy home and etc., etc. People don't know what poor is. Our modern day has redefined poor. If you go to bed tonight with a full stomach and a roof over your head and clothes to wear, consider yourself blessed. There are many people who live in abject poverty, who spend their days scratching around to try and make food. I heard of somebody who said they went to Zimbabwe. It was the maid that looked after my mom as she was dying, and she said even there on their public holidays, people don't even take their holidays. They're busy working to try and put food on the table. That's our neighbor. Next door neighbor. And I sent an email around recently where the workers of Eskom threw away their food that was given to them because they wanted hot meals. And we say we're poor. Contentment has to do with thankfulness. And one of the saddest things with us as human beings is that we tend to take things for granted. I was just thinking about our health as I looked at somebody who was disabled the other day, and I want to mention one or two things about people. But you know, I just thought, you know, if I had to be crippled or blinded for a month or so, not knowing that I'd receive my sight or be able to walk again, how much more I would appreciate my sight. How much more I'd appreciate being able to walk. Sometimes we see people that are disabled and they are people that are going around giving motivational talks, motivating able-bodied, well people who are too lazy to get up off their butts and do some work, who feel sorry for themselves. Fanny Crosby, the great writer of gospel songs, wrote at least 8,000 hymns, was blinded when she was only 6 weeks old. A country doctor put something in her eyes that he thought was eye drops, and he blinded her. She not only wrote many hymns, some of the hymns we sing, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine, Oh What a Foretaste of Glory Divine, Heir of Salvation, Purchase of God, Born of His Spirit. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Saviour all the day long. She wrote that hymn, these are just two that I could think of, To God Be the Glory, Great Things He Has Done, and Great Our Redemption Through Jesus the Son, but purer and higher and greater will be the wonder, the transport when Jesus we see. I was amazed to see that she only wrote her first hymn when she was in her 40s. At the age of 8, she started writing poems. And when she started writing hymns, at least 8,000 of them. And this is what she wrote when she was 8 years old. Oh, what a happy child I am, although I cannot see. I am resolved that in this world contented I shall be. How many blessings I enjoy that other people don't. To weep and sigh because I'm blind, I cannot, and I won't. And you know, when we read things like that, it's a challenge to us of our ingratitude of the blessings of God, how God has blessed us. Surely we can say, Lord, I've got enough. Just look at your body. Just look at your family. Just look at the blessings God has blessed you with. Helen Keller, who went blind and deaf due to an illness when she was only 19 months old, said this. This is one of her famous quotes. Everything has its wonders, even darkness and silence. And I learn whatever state I may be in, therein to be content. Another famous quote of hers that's actually on the statue, that's on the pedestal of the statue of her, in Washington, is this. The most beautiful things in the world cannot be seen or even touched. They must be felt with the heart. Aren't you blessed? Aren't I blessed? Isn't God a good God? Hasn't He given us so much? And yet we covet. And this, thou shalt not covet, this commandment that has been perhaps not taught enough. In fact, the opposite has been taught. Tell God what you want. Tell Him what car you want, and tell Him what color you want, and tell Him when to deliver it. Has been taught from pulpits. What garbage. John MacArthur said this. The antidote for covetousness is contentment. The two are in opposition. Whereas the covetous person worships himself, the contented person worships God. Contentment comes from trusting God. And that's what it is. Covetousness is idolatry. That's worshiping God. There were a whole lot of quotes, and I would have liked to have time to have read them all to you today, but I've selected, I felt, some of the best. But C.S. Lewis, the man who wrote the books of Narnia, The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe, etc., etc., and the Screwtape Letters, things like that, he said this: there are two kinds of people. Firstly, those who say to God, "Thy will be done." Secondly, those to whom God says, "All right then, have it your way." Two kinds of people. What kind of person are you? God, thy will be done. Or those to whom God says, "Okay, have it your way." That's what happened with Balaam. Balaam was greedy and he wanted the gifts that were offered to him. And he went and he asked the Lord again and again, could he go and curse Israel so that he could get these gifts? And we know the story of the Lord, the angel even made the donkey speak to him. And sometimes we need a donkey to speak to us. Actually, while I'm thinking about it, I'm going to forget to give my illustration, and my wife's going to be upset because she tied the carrot to the fishing pole. They say that illustrations sort of stick in your mind, okay? Have you ever seen this one with a carrot and the donkey, and you sit on the back of the donkey and you go like this, and the donkey keeps on running? Well, you know, yesterday on TBN I was watching Tony Campola. I can't remember the whole illustration, but Tony Campola was talking about this old greyhound that was playing with the kids, and this greyhound used to win races. And there was this dialogue where the greyhound was asked, you know, didn't you used to run races, and weren't you winning? And eventually the ultimate end of this illustration of his was the greyhound said, "One day I found out that the rabbit that I was chasing wasn't real. The hare that I was chasing wasn't real." Now, I don't know if you've seen those races where they drag that thing and the dogs try and catch it. Won't it be sad one day when you end up on your deathbed and you find out that the hare that you've been chasing wasn't real? The carrot you've been trying to get, that's been dangled in front of you. And you know, some women, they go after 9 carrots and 18 carrots, not just 1 carrot. The fact of the matter is, you're never going to find satisfaction out of those things. Watchman Nee said this: only God can satisfy the Christian heart. Man cannot. I think Watchman Nee had his tongue cut out. He was tortured. He was treated terribly eventually before he was killed. But a man who has written books that are so rich, a man who is so close to the Lord, only God can satisfy the Christian heart. And you know, you can live your whole life calling yourself a Christian with unsatisfied desires, or you can find that abundant life that Jesus has promised. Jesus doesn't hang out a carrot in front of us. His promises are yea and amen. John Piper said this: God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in Him. But God is most glorified when we are most satisfied with Him. Are you satisfied? Satisfied with the Lord? I find that when I start spending more time with the Lord and start exposing myself to praise and worship and that, I lose an interest in other things that before were priorities. It's got to do with what hunger, what appetites we feed him. A.B. Simpson said this: when you become satisfied with God, everything else so loses its charm that he can give it to us without harm. And that's very interesting. When we become satisfied with God, everything else loses its charm to the extent that God can actually give it to you and they don't harm you. And you know, sometimes God does bless Christians, and God does bless those who are satisfied with Him. But you'll find that He blesses them for a reason. He blesses them to be a blessing, because they don't climb into their hearts. They're not things that they allow to become idols. When Christians find contentment in the Lord, they will be content with what they have. We've seen in 1 Timothy 6 verse 8 that they'll be content just having food and clothes. In Luke chapter 3:14, we see John the Baptist speaking to the Roman soldiers and says, be content with your wages. Christians shouldn't be at the front of the picket line, toying to get an increase. We should be content. And in Philippians 4, we see that we should be content with whatever circumstances we have. Philippians 4, and I'm going to read from verse 10. Paul writing says, I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you have renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you have been concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. I'm not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content. I want to tell you folks, Helen Keller, Fanny Crosby, Paul the Apostle didn't have contentment drop into their laps. I've seen disabled, handicapped people who are full of bitterness. Contentment has to be learned. And Paul said, I have learned to be content. It's something that's contrary to our human nature. It's not a gift that just sort of like falls from heaven. I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need. I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Another one of those passages of scriptures where people just quote that, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, but they don't know the preceding verses. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can be content no matter what the circumstances. It's interesting to notice that in this situation that Paul was in, only the Philippian church remembered him and provided for him. I sent out an email to a lot of our missionaries that we support a couple of days ago, and I got a reply from Phil and Sharon and in France, and he was just saying how workers slow down because the construction industry has slowed down, but he works as an electrician to make money so that he and his wife can minister the gospel in France. And you know, there are many missionaries who are in the situation that Paul's in who have to be tent makers because the church doesn't support them. And it's not something new. Here in Paul's time, the Philippian church was the only church, he said, that had provided his needs. And people sit at home and they're not happy with the television set that they've got and they want a bigger one and a better this and a better that. And when it comes to giving to the missions, we've got too much debt to part with any money. Contentment goes beyond money and possessions. And there are many areas in which one can bring up this topic, but one that I just want to speak about because it's relevant to the church is that people are sometimes not content with their ministry. And this quote of D.L. Moody really caught my attention. D.L. Moody said, there are many of us willing to do great things for the Lord, but few of us are willing to do little things. Many of us are willing to do great things for the Lord. And we hear about people who, I want to do something for the Lord. And they come to the church. And you say, well, you know, would you like to serve tea? No, I want to do something great for the Lord. I don't want to make sure that there's toilet rolls and that type of thing. Somebody else can do that. You know, I've got too much talent for that type of thing. The man who's in our history books for what happened, the civil rights movement in America, he said this. If a man is called to be a street sweeper, he should sweep the streets even as Michelangelo painted, or Beethoven composed music, or Shakespeare wrote poetry. He should sweep the streets so well that all the hosts of heaven and earth will pause to say, Here lived a great street sweeper who did his job well. Are you content with your ministry? Sometimes God can't trust us with any more because we've got the wrong attitude. And God proves us in the small things. And I'm always amazed when one has a church and people who have been serving the Lord for 20, 30 years who should be on retirement and taking things a bit easy have to run around doing things and healthy body people sit around and do nothing. And that's a shame on us. And we've cultivated a society of children who think that life owes them something and who have a sense of entitlement. We've got a young man who Bevis helped out and given him transport and all the rest, and he's got a job at a video store working from 10 in the morning till 10 at night, and I was just saying to her on the way to church today, at least he's doing something. Not saying, oh well, you know, I'm only getting 700 grand a week. So what? You got a job. Do it until you find something better. And stop sitting around feeling sorry for yourself. But we've got this lazy culture that has developed. And it's even worse in countries like Europe and that, where people just sit at home and do nothing and live off the government. Just a little more. Just a little more. Just a little more and then I'll be happy. Francois Penthon said this, mankind, by the perverse depravity of their nature, esteem that which they have most desired as of no value the moment it is possessed. I'm going to read that again because I know it's written in some archaic language. Mankind, by the perverse depravity of their nature, esteem that which they have most desired as of no value the moment it is possessed, and torment themselves with the fruitless wishes for that which is beyond their reach. Oh, if only I had this, a bicycle. And you give them a bicycle, and they want a 50cc. Then you give them a 50cc, and they want a motorbike. And you give them a motorbike, and they want a car. And then they want a better car. And then they want a house. And then they want a better... And that's mankind. When you start trying to chase after things to find fulfillment, you'll never be satisfied. You'll never be happy. Charles Spurgeon said this. He was the great, well-known, renowned preacher. You say if I had a little more, I should be satisfied. You make a mistake. If you aren't content with what you have, you would not be satisfied if it was doubled. We started with that article about enough. And I want to ask you again, and you don't have to answer me, have you got enough? I've got enough. In fact, I've got more than enough. God has blessed me and blessed me. And you know, when we start allowing God to deal with our heart, we start realizing how much we've got to be grateful for, how thankful we can be. I want to finish with three last quotes, and then I'm going to show a little clip. I showed this to the folks at the prayer meeting a month or two ago from David Ring. Martin Luther said this, I have held many things in my hands and have lost them all. But whatever I have placed in God's hands, that I still possess. And that teaches us this principle, and it's a biblical principle. You can only keep what you give away. That's the paradox of Christianity. You can only keep what you give away. Jesus said it. Whoever loves his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake will gain it. And that's what God's called us to. He's called us to store up treasure in heaven, where moth and thieves do not corrupt and thieves don't break through and steal. We had an incident, I think it was Wednesday, we'd gone to work and Bev's son's girlfriend was in the flat outside and obviously people had looked through the gate, seen no cars, no sign of life. Came in, helped himself to his flat screen TV. She saw them just as they were leaving and all the rest. And that kind of thing carries on this time of the year. People come and do some affirmative shopping. Okay. The fact of the matter is, there's something that cannot be stolen from you. And that's your investment in heaven. Don't get too close and attached to the things of this life, okay? They rust, they decay, even in the bank. Nowadays, people put their money in a couple of banks because you don't know which bank's going to go under. Madame Guyon said this, and this is one of the ones that I really like because it's got some catchy alliteration in it. To rob God of nothing, to refuse of Him nothing, to require of Him nothing. This is great perfection. To rob God of nothing, to refuse of Him nothing, and to require of Him nothing. This is great perfection. Are you robbing God? Are you refusing to do certain things? Are you requiring certain things from Him? That's not what this word teaches us. To rob God of nothing, to refuse of Him nothing, to require of Him nothing. This is great perfection. And that's where you'll find contentment. And then lastly, Augustine, one of the church fathers, said, God, You have made us for Yourself, and our hearts are restless till they find their rest in You. If you are restless, if you are dissatisfied, if you are discontent, I wonder if you can call yourself a Christian. Certainly not the Christian God wants you to be. Because Jesus said to that woman at the well, whoever drinks of the water that I have to give will never thirst again.